My name's Philippa Matthews. I'm an infection doctor in the UK and I lead research into hepatitis B virus. I'm going to talk briefly about clinical trials. So what is a clinical trial and why would we do one? Well, trials allow us to test the effect of a new approach. That might be a medicine or a vaccine or some other kind of new intervention. Trials can also allow us to investigate the effect of existing interventions used in new ways. For example, we might have two drugs that we already use, but we want to investigate what happens if we use them together in a new combination. We aim to do this in a way that's fair, open and transparent, and reproducible. And it's clearly crucially important that there's confidence and trust in the results of the study. That provides evidence for what we do in clinical practice. So let's take hepatitis B virus infection as an example. This is a virus that can cause long-term liver infections, and in a proportion of people infected, this can lead on to long-term liver complications. We do have treatments, but they're only given to selected people who we think are at the highest risk of these long-term complications. The medicines can switch off the activity of the virus, but don't cure it completely, and that means that people taking treatment have to remain on it long-term. So there's clearly a need for new therapies, aiming to eradicate or cure the virus completely. These might be new drugs, new vaccines, or combinations of these kind of approaches. There are also other important questions like, could we give shorter courses of treatment, and should we treat more people who are living with this infection? So this is where clinical trials become important. So phase one studies are those that consider safety and side effects. They're usually done in just a small number of healthy volunteers. There'll be very close monitoring, potentially lots of blood tests, and participants may be asked to keep a diary of symptoms or side effects. If this is conducted safely, then we can move on to phase two. This is where the intervention gets applied to people actually with the condition. There's still a focus on safety, but we move on to be especially interested in efficacy. That is, does this treatment or intervention actually work as intended? We might also address other questions like what's the optimal dose? These kind of studies may involve tens or hundreds of people, and they provide the foundations for moving on to the biggest studies. These are the phase three studies, and this determines how the new approach actually compares with the best existing standard of care approach. These may need hundreds or thousands of people to answer the question, and for this reason they're often done in multiple sites and maybe international. We can also divide the study into arms. This is where we have different groups of participants who may each receive a different treatment or combination of treatments so that we can make cross comparisons. It's also important to know that before any studies are done in humans, there's a detailed laboratory phase to make sure that there's enough evidence to move into clinical trials. At the other end of the process, we also think about phase four. This means that there's ongoing scrutiny and data collection even after the treatment's been approved, so that we can continue to keep an eye on how the intervention's performing and whether there are any side effects or risks associated. So who's involved in a clinical trial? Well, we all recognise the key place of patients and healthcare workers, of course, but there are many other people involved. These include those who design and lead the studies and the laboratory scientists who process samples. Around this, there's also many layers of infrastructure, so management, healthcare providers, pharmacists, for example. Then there's a regulatory layer of approvals and ethics. And then at the end of a study, of course, the people who take an interest in the results and how these might be applied. Let's think briefly about the language of clinical trials. You may hear reference to the power of a study. This is often related to the number of individuals recruited. You can imagine that if we only recruit a small number of participants to a study, the results might be difficult to interpret, but the study is easier to do, quicker and cheaper. On the other hand, if we recruit a large number of participants with really diverse backgrounds, then we might have a lot more confidence in the results that we see, but the study is much more difficult, expensive and time-consuming. So in the real world, we have to strike a balance between these two, making sure that we recruit enough people that we can be confident in the results, but without making the study too onerous or expensive to deliver. Another term you may hear is that of bias. This can also be thought of as skew or prejudice in the results. One way that we tackle this when setting up a study is to randomise. That means that people are randomly allocated to whether they receive a new drug, a dummy drug, or the existing drug that's already in use. We may also blind the study. That means that a participant doesn't know which of those interventions they're receiving. And sometimes we double blind. That means that the study team also doesn't know which participant is receiving which intervention. So if you're asked to take part in a clinical trial, you'll receive written and verbal information, and that should be clear and available in your preferred language. You'll have the opportunity to ask questions, to think through the options, and to discuss with your family and friends. Whether or not you decide to participate does not have any influence on other aspects of your clinical care or treatment, and you can change your mind at any time. If you'd like more sources of information, there are a few suggestions on this slide. Thanks for listening.